Restoration by Rose Tremain. Read by Rupert Degas. I am, I discover, a very untidy man. Look at me. Without my periwig, I am an affront to neatness. My hair, what is left of it, is the color of sand and wiry as hog's bristles. My ears are of uneven size. My forehead is splattered with freckles. My nose, which of course my wig can't conceal, however low I wear it, is unceremoniously flat, as if I had been hit at birth. Was I hit at birth? I do not believe so, as my parents were gentle and kindly people, but I will never know now. They died in a fire in 1662. My father had a nose like a Roman emperor. This straight, fierce nose would neaten up my face, but alas, I don't possess it. Perhaps I am not my father's child. I am erratic, immoderate, greedy, boastful, and sad. Perhaps I am the son of Amos Treefeller, the old man who made head molds for my father's millinery work. Like him, I am fond of the feel of objects made of polished wood, my telescope, for instance. I don't know whether you can imagine me yet. I'm 37 years old, as this year, 1664, moves towards its end. My stomach is large and also freckled, although it has seldom been exposed to the sun. It looks as if a flight of minute moths had landed on it in the night. I'm not tall, but this is the age of the high heel. I strive to be particular about my clothes, but am terribly in the habit of dropping morsels of dinner on them. My eyes are blue and limpid. In childhood, I was considered angelic and was frequently buttoned inside a suit of blue moiré. My mother went to her fiery death still believing that I was a person of honour. In the scented gloom of Amos Treefeller's back room, the place of all our private conversations, she would take my hand and whisper her hopes for my splendid future. What she couldn't see, and what I had not the heart to point out, was that we no longer live in an honourable age. What has dawned instead is the age of possibility. And it is only the elderly, as my mother was, and the truculently myopic, as my friend Pierce is, who haven't noticed this and are not preparing to take full advantage of it. So, to me again, whither my thoughts are extremely fond of returning. My name is Robert Merivel, and although I'm dissatisfied with other of my appendages, viz. My flat nose, I am exceedingly happy with my name, because to its Frenchness I owe a great deal of my fortune. Since the return of the king, French things are in fashion. Heels, mirrors, sedan chairs, silver toothbrushes, fans and fricasses. There was a beginning to the story, or possibly a variety of beginnings. These are they. 1. In 1636, when I was 9 years old, I carried out my first anatomical dissection. My instruments were a kitchen knife, 2 mustard spoons made of bone, 4 millinery pins, and a measuring rod. The cadaver was a starling. I performed this feat of exploration in our coal cellar, into which, through the coal hole, came a crepuscular light, augmented a little by the 2 candles I placed on my dissecting tray. As I cut into the thorax, a well of excitement began to fill and glimmer within me. I had, I suddenly recognised, caught a glimpse of my own future. 2. At Caius College, Cambridge, in 1647, I met my poor friend, Pierce. We were both by then students of anatomy, and though our natures are so antipathetic, our rejection of Galenic theory, coupled with our desire to discover the precise function of each part of the body in relation to the whole, formed a bond between us. One evening, Pierce came up to my room in a state of hilarious perturbation. His face, habitually grey-toned and flaky, was rubicund and damp. His stern green eyes suddenly afflicted with a louche brightness.
"Merivel, Merivel," he babbled, "come down to my room. A person is standing in it who has a visible heart." Have you been drinking, Pierce? I asked. No! Exploded Pierce. Now come down and you'll see for yourself this extraordinary phenomenon. And for a shilling, the person says he will permit us to touch it.
Touch his heart?
Yes.
It's not a cadaver, then, if its mind is on money.
Now come, Merivel, before he flees into the night and is lost to our research for all eternity.
We descended to Pierce's room, where a fire was burning in the small grate.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.